All right.
The blue on the sea, loose incomplete under sky, so smoky blue-green. I can't foresee a dissident shake, so we dance the sidewalk clean. My memory is muddy, what's this river that I'm in? New Orleans, a sinking man, and I don't want to swim.
Hi, I'm Kalypso Homan, a sixth grader who lives in New Orleans, and today is the one-year anniversary of Katrina, the worst disaster to ever hit the United States of America. At this time last year, the hurricane winds were dying down in New Orleans as the storm passed north, but the worst for my city was just beginning. The waters from the storm surge smashed through the poorly designed levees, and slowly the waters rose until about 80% of the city was underwater. That's my house right there, the pink one that's leaning. Thankfully, everyone in my family is healthy, but others were not so fortunate. Katrina and the broken levees killed more than 1,800 people, and occasionally dead bodies are still being found in the rubble. Plus, there's still more than 750 people classified as missing. I made an online movie about Katrina in New Orleans to mark the 6-month anniversary of the tragedy, to let people know two things. New Orleans is a unique and wonderful city that is certainly worth saving. And after 6 months, not much has happened, and we need help in lots of it. Well, quite a few people saw my first movie, and some of them told me it really made a difference, so I decided to make another one, the one that you are watching right now, to allow people to see what life is like in New Orleans 1 year after Katrina through the eyes of an 11-year-old girl. So here's my movie, and I hope you like it.
We are all traveling in the footsteps of those that come before, and we'll all be reunited on that new and sunlit shore. Oh, when a saint will march in, oh, when a saint could march in. Lord, how I want to be in that number. Here we the saints go marching.
So, a lot's happened to my city of New Orleans in the past 6 months since I made my movie. Some of it good and some of it bad.
Hi!
Today is Kalypso's 11th birthday. Happy birthday to you.
On the day of my birthday, we found something very small and fragile in the driveway.
Well, we found a bird, like, a while ago, maybe a week. There's a nest right up there. And it was a dove, and it's apparently it laid eggs, and most of them hatched. We found a baby dove out under one of the cars, and now we're trying to save it so it won't get eaten by a cat. Let's go look at the bird. Well, there's the dove right there that we found under the car.
Aww, he's cute.
His name is Mojo, and we're gonna try to make, like, we're gonna try to teach him how to fly so he can be safe from all the evil things out there.
In fact, the very next day, he flew away, so he must have been a very good learner.
The disco ball is for my birthday party tomorrow, and I can't wait. Yay!
First, we went to play croquet at City Park. And then we hit a meatwad pinata with our bat. Meatwad fought hard, but our bats were too much to overcome. We thought there'd be meat in his belly, but instead there was candy. Then it was off to Pandora's for the best snowballs in the world.
They all smell good.
You get ice cream in here?
We stayed up late, and in the morning we formed a band and sung a song about Walgreens.
One, two, three, go!
Walgreens is dead on the-
see, music runs in our family.
You got blood on your face, a big dust splash. Somebody put a blizzard in me.
For my mom's 40th birthday, we threw her a surprise party. But instead of acting surprised, my mom just started crying. Emotionally, it's been a very difficult year for all of us.
Yeah, I cried when I saw him too.
Her mom, dad, brother, and sister-in-law all came into town to celebrate.
Your present.
So.
We made my mom a cake, but as usual, she ruined it.
Well, it got spit all over.
Not only did my mom turn 40, but she also graduated with a master's degree from Xavier. That's the school my dad teaches at.
And when you hear all this, the easiest thing to do is to do nothing at all.
The graduation ceremony was pretty boring, but Barack Obama gave a very good speech.
It asks you to realize there's more to life than being rich or thin or young or famous or safe or entertained. It asks you to recognize that there are people out there who need you.
Therese Marie Fitzpatrick.
We were all very proud of my mom. I did a lot of fun things this summer. I went to water parks, lit off fireworks on the 4th of July, and just fooled around. I had an awesome summer. I did a lot of fun things, but in New Orleans' long history, this was the saddest summer ever.
The cotton is high. Oh, your dad is rich and your ma is good looking. So hush, little baby, don't you cry. One of these mornings you're going to rise up singing, then you'll spread your wings and you'll take the sky. But till that morning, never nothing can harm you. With daddy and mammy standing by.
My grandpa's a storm adjuster and knows a lot about devastation. Here's what he said just about a week ago driving around New Orleans.
It brings back memories of how devastating Andrew was, and when I saw it, I didn't believe that I would ever see anything even remotely like the devastation of Andrew, where things were just scraped to the earth. Trees, bushes, houses, businesses, everything. But it was a defined area. I mean, it had a beginning and an end, where this is endless. It's just as far as you can look down the street ahead of me. There's, you know, a view of just 1 year later, desolation. There's no people, there's no cars, there's no activity. It's an abandoned area. Houses on top of houses. We've been driving since Lakeview area, and we're currently in the 9th Ward, which is one of the worst areas hit. And you can see the similarity of Andrew in 1992, where all you would see is a concrete step, as these are right here. But that's all it would be in the whole area. And this is a whole city. I'm from Omaha, Nebraska, a population of about 500,000. And it would be similar to taking the whole city of Omaha and and just wiping it out and then leaving and doing nothing for a year. It's just hard to imagine.
This is my friend Miranda. I've known her since first grade. And while we're waiting on our FEMA trailer, she's already had one for 6 months. Her house is almost ready to move into. So, Miranda, what's it like living in a FEMA trailer?
It's small, but it's something to live in. Better than, you know, nothing.
Yeah. So, are you gonna give us a tour?
Yeah, come on.
All right.
This is the trailer, the big white box that everybody talks about. This is the kitchen. This is a bed that folds out into a twin bed. This is the master bedroom. Master, quote, quote, quote. The kitchen. These are the bunk beds. I wish you luck getting up into this one. Kali, would you like to try getting up in this one? Okay, this is my room, my very little room. It has a beautiful view of the toiletry pipe. This is the bathroom. And my mom tried to convince us to move somewhere else, but there's no place like NOLA.
So Miranda, with the 1 year anniversary of Katrina coming up, what's it like living in New Orleans?
Well, I love New Orleans. My mom's not so happy, but I love it. And like, you can just go on the street and do this and nobody will look at you like you're stupid. Whereas in where I was staying, everybody thought you were weird if you like just did that or that. And I like New Orleans a lot better because a lot of people are so much more funky and go with the flow rather than uptight.
Oh, hi, my name is Scarlett Navia, and I'm born and raised in New Orleans with Colombian parents who I believe saw the movie Gone with the Wind. And when they arrived in New Orleans, decided they could name me Scarlett. My neighborhood was flooded. My house is 2 feet off the ground, and it was 4 feet of water in my house, which remained for over 10 days. Really funky, dark water, which really destroyed all my furniture. And because they took so long to let us into the zip code, it really damaged the whole house. But we're almost finished rebuilding inside. We have a lot to do outside. It's been a lot of work, a lot of decisions, too many decisions at one time. But I'm excited about coming back, especially after living in such small space for the past year.
Look at the car. It says Geek Dinner. So far, I've been to two of the Geek Dinners. They're for bloggers in New Orleans to get together and know each other.
Activists really have to stay active. We have to find a sustainable way of, working with our neighbors to change and transform our neighborhoods and our city.
I went to the Rising Tide Conference, and I asked one of the smartest people I know to explain what it was.
So, this is Maitri. She's a New Orleans blogger. And Maitri, can you explain to us what exactly is the Rising Tide?
The Rising Tide is a gathering of everyone who is concerned about New Orleans and cares to see about its recovery, or see it coming back, rather. It so happens that a lot of us are voices on the internet. We're bloggers, just like you. And we were sitting around and talking about a conference at, Mark Mosley brought up and said, whoever's interested in getting this out there and getting more coverage for New Orleans and talking about the issues that really matter to New Orleanians, if we can work something out like this, that would be great. And we were shooting for the weekend of Katrina, the one year anniversary of Katrina, because it's important at this time to let America know that 1 year after Katrina, we're not okay. And we were able to get a lot of people together, and we did it.
So, what do you think I can do as an 11-year-old girl to help the city of New Orleans recover?
I think that the young people of New Orleans, and by young I mean, you know, people like you, and I feel like I'm 13 myself, so, you know. I think what we all can do is to explain to other people in our own terms, in your own terms, what it means to live here. And you can really help 11-year-olds in the rest of the nation and the rest of the world realize that life is not simple here. You know, you go to meetings as an 11-year-old. I experienced the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait as a 15-year-old, and that responsibility is not just for adults, it's also for people your age, and that there are two things involved. There, you know, every day you wake up and you wonder whether to enjoy the world as it is or whether to make the world a better place. And it's kind of hard to plan your day when you have that decision to make. But I think when you live in New Orleans, you have that dual responsibility. And especially as an 11-year-old, it's really time for you to start thinking. And you have. And it's time for a lot of us to start thinking, what can we do to enjoy the world as it is, and what can we do to make it a better place? So if you can present New Orleans to people of your generation and what needs to be done here, if you can translate all of this rising tide and the planning process and everything, get the gist of it and put it on your blog and encourage other people of your age to come to your blog, that's a great service you can do.
I've been to a lot of planning meetings. The people in my neighborhood are working really hard to rebuild New Orleans. Maybe a little bit too hard, because they seem a little bit crazy. At these meetings, I've met some famous politicians, like the mayor of our city, Ray Nagin. And today, at Warren Easton High School, I heard a speech by the president. But the video is not very good. I had to use my cell phone because of security. We're standing here on a field of rubble in front of Warren Easton High School. And there used to be a hospital standing here, and now it's just dirt and bricks. So 1 year after Katrina, and we still need lots of help.
The music of Fats Domino. The stories of Tennessee Williams, shotgun houses and iron lattice balconies, seafood gumbo, red beans and rice on Mondays.
Today, I heard a speech from President Bush, the most powerful man on the planet, and he's said a lot of things, but I don't think that he knows what people like us are going through here in New Orleans. And you've seen the neighborhood just now. It's very torn up. The president's words are very powerful, but I don't know if even his words can fix this. What do you two think it would be like to be here when all the water rushing up?
I can't imagine. I mean, I would be very scared. And even like being here and seeing firsthand what this neighborhood looks like now, it's still so surreal. Even though I'm here, it's really hard to comprehend and get your mind around just the vastness of the devastation.
I think about what it would sound like and just to see all of a sudden that water just moving like one solid block. But yeah. The idea that you'd be in something that you've always felt was sturdy and solid, and all of a sudden feel it shift. And it's weird too, if you look at the houses, like obviously back here, but it almost looks like a Dali painting, how they're almost twisted, and what was straight, like things are bowed, but what it would feel like to be in a house, and all of a sudden to feel like the floor shift one way.
Only a few schools are reopening. The closest school to my house is Thurgood Marshall. It's a beautiful 100-year-old building. It's closed, well, at least sort of. Very few of the abandoned schools are locked, and the buildings fall apart more and more each day.
Well, we got into the building, and there's a bunch of instruments just completely beaten up. It really stinks in here, too. Here's a helmet. These people used to walk by our house in a marching band. Our dogs would always go crazy. It really stinks in here. Every time it rains, this building falls apart more and more because the roof still isn't fixed.
It makes me sad to think of all the school supplies they had to throw away because of the flood and resulting mold. Inside these schools, it's haunting. It's like a moment in time, just froze. These kids all at school Friday, August 26. 3 days later, their lives changed forever.
I'm in the sixth grade, and today's the first day of school, but I'm not that nervous because I've been to 8 different schools before, all around the world, in Nebraska, Jerusalem, Jordan, and California, and now here.
Do you know what it means to miss New Orleans?
Only about half our population is back. We drove to Texas to see some of our best friends.
I know I'm not wrong.
They lived in New Orleans their whole lives, but now they live in Houston.
I stay away. Mr. Moss covered fine. The tall should be fine.
She's at the storm, but she'll be on her way home, girl.
I'd like to see the lazy Mississippi.
Hello.
Hi.
Okay. So these are the Moncondivants, and they lived in New Orleans, and they moved to Houston, Texas after Katrina. So what's life like here, and do you miss New Orleans? If you could move back, would you?
Okay, life here is different. It's not bad or anything, it's just different, and I miss home, and like we can't even buy the same stuff to make the same food that we had at home and stuff. So it's different, and like our family's all over the place now. We have some family in Georgia and some back home, and nobody here except for my grandparents, so it's different.
Okay, life here is like different, yeah. But I don't really like it as much as I like New Orleans, because like you could just walk outside and see people, and it's like entertaining to see different people walking down the street and all dressed up and stuff. But here, when you walk outside, it's just like nobody's outside. They don't go outside like ever. And yeah, and if I could go back home, I would, just like not right now, because it's not really back to what it used to be.
I don't know what's gonna happen.
Yeah, and all the restaurants aren't open and everything, so. Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, what?
You missed the French Quarter, that's what you just said.
Oh, yeah. One of the things I miss most was the French Quarter. Like, because Café du Monde, and like, you can't even get that anywhere here, beignets.
Mike's, just about his entire family is in New Orleans.
And we were living right next door to his mom, and everyone would stop at his mom's house, and we would get to see them, you know, all throughout the week, on the weekends. So that's really hard, not being there, being the heart of everything going on with the family.
Yeah, the separation from the family is definitely number one thing that's different. You get hurtful sometimes, but I guess we have to deal with the cause we have, and we're going to do the best we can with that. You know, we want to do what's right for our kids, number one.
The main reason we decided to stay is that our oldest was doing so much better in school. She was in 10th grade when the hurricane hit, and we saw a huge improvement in her grades and her attitude towards school, and that was one of the deciding factors to make us stay here. The school in New Orleans was not the best environment for her, and she was having a lot of difficulty there. And when we saw a big change in her report card, that was one of the deciding factors.
People say that the schools here in Houston, Texas are better than they are in New Orleans. And why is that?
Well, like, the schools here, they have more money. Their school system has more money to take care of stuff in the school. Like, at my high school in New Orleans, we didn't even have a gym. And here, we have two gyms, one for the girls and one for the boys. And we have tennis, like, six tennis courts and stuff that they couldn't even afford back in New Orleans. So money is, like, one of the big reasons why Houston schools are more, like, better than schools in New Orleans. And the schools here are more diverse, too. And a lot of the teachers really do what they're supposed to do in the class and not just getting by being in the school system. And that's why the schools are better here.
I think the schools here in Texas suburbs area is better because people really put an emphasis on putting their money and resources into something that's going to benefit the children and this environment. It's making an investment in your future. Kids don't have to worry about not having enough textbooks, not having enough tissue paper in the bathroom or a bathroom that's clean. And it's just a beautiful environment, and the money goes directly to the schools, and they're using it to what it's supposed to be used for.
You can directly see where your taxpaying money is gone, you know. It's not no guessing, because, you know, your streets are in good conditions, your schools are clean, and like my wife said, all the school supplies are there.
One thing that really bothers me about here, because people always say, I know how you feel, and like have no idea what's going on with us.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, yeah, to add on what she said, like, they always say, oh, I know just how you feel, and they really don't, because they don't know what it's like to, like, have your family all split up all over the place and not really knowing where everyone is and what's going on with the rest of your family and friends. So they really don't know what it's like.
And being able to communicate.
Yeah, and our cell phones weren't working or anything, so it's not like we could get in contact with other people, and it was really hard.
We're in a really nice neighborhood and everything now, but it doesn't feel like home. It still doesn't feel like home.
New Orleans just has that spirit about it. Whether you say it's the food, it's the people, it's just the surroundings, and I think it's just something you won't find anywhere else. And that's just one thing you just always miss.
Okay, well, when I first came here and we got into school, like, the first week, people were trying to talk to me, like, be nice to me and stuff because they knew about the hurricane from the news or whatever. And, like, I didn't want to make friends because I thought, like, oh, in a week we're going to go back home, everything's going to be back to normal, and I don't want to make friends here and then have to leave. And then once you realize that you're really stuck here, then you're like, oh, man, I need to make friends, you know? And, like, even then, you still feel like you might go back home, like, your parents might change their mind later on, and you can, everything go back to normal. But, like, in reality, even back home is not back to normal, because not everybody's back home yet, because they can't. Their houses are still messed up or whatever.
And both my parents are back in New Orleans. Their house is probably at this time 11, 12, 1 year anniversary of Katrina, maybe 98% ready. They're still living in a trailer, but they should be in their house within the next week or two, which they're looking very forward to.
If it was up to you, like, would you move back to New Orleans or would you stay here?
I don't think I would go back right now because you don't know, like, if another hurricane season comes, what's going to happen. And I think I would just stay here for a while and then eventually go back once you see what's going to happen with the next hurricane season.
In New Orleans, I could walk around the corner to the grocery store, walk a couple blocks to get crawfish, and that's just not the case here. You have to drive everywhere.
So school isn't the same, and I know I miss you, and my family misses you too, and it's just not the same in New Orleans without you, and goodbye.
I'm gonna miss you!
It was great to see our friends, but it was also sad. But you can't stay sad for too long in New Orleans.
There you go.
I asked this talented new friend of mine to sing a song about me and Katrina, and she did a great job. Notice her optimism. It's contagious.
Lucky, I have a talent that will come handy for us all.
Yeah.
And we New Orleans people will work together and keep things going. It takes people with people to make something. You can hoard it all and you'll lose it all in the end. It takes many people succeeding for a place to succeed.
You're right.
So people helping people is what gets it.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Good luck to you. There will be a way, and you will reaccomplish, and you will be a stronger person for it. It's hard. It's hard on you. It hurts.
Yeah.
It does. But it is. There's a reason for this. It will make us stronger people, and we will know more what to do and how to go about it.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Okay. Ready, Colleen?
Mm-hmm.
So, why do you think so many crazy and fun people do that here?
Because it's the place to be. No other place is like this. And that's the truth. And that's it.
Do you know what it means to miss New Orleans when that's where you left your heart?
You know what? I think that all of us in New Orleans are going to be okay. It's just going to take some really hard work.
I miss New Orleans.